So Chennai is one of the largest cities in India, and it is facing this crippling water crisis in what is being considered one of the hottest summers in India. I mean the four lakes that supply the capital of the southern state of Tamil Nadu, that's where Chennai is, have dried up, and together at this point of time, they contain just 1% of the total volume of water they had last year. So residents of the city don't have water to drink, don't have water to make food, bathe, wash. People are working from home, malls are shut, restaurants are shut because their bathrooms are not working. Also, the natural instinct is to kind of blame the situation on climate change, but unfortunately, this has been a man-made crisis because we have not taken measures to conserve water. We have not, I mean, not just in the south of India, but also in the northeastern parts of India, where we are not growing crops. We are an agrarian country. We are not growing crops which require lesser water. We have this absolutely no water management in the country with 1.3 billion population. So this was bound to happen in a city like Chennai, which witnessed one of the worst floods last year. So between a flood and a tsunami and now a complete drought, there has been a climate problem. Now the more sagacious thing to do is to address that with environmentalist. When you completely negate the problem, this was bound to happen. Climate change activists have long argued that water will be the political flashpoint of the 21st century in India. Now, water-stressed India will likely be one of the first places to test that theory. If the water management is not happening, there is politics in water management. I mean, there's a long growing politics between Chennai and the neighboring state about who gets more water from the Kaveri River. So if the country is not able to manage these issues, and if we are fighting over water, if there's a political fight over water, then you will never be ready for a crisis like this. It affects both rich and poor, but will largely affect the poor because, I mean, at this point of time, when there are no rains, what are you dependent on? You are dependent on water tankers. And especially when there is a situation like this, when there's a drought, there is an inflation because water tankers will be more expensive. Now, the poor in the country, which do not have enough money to buy their three meals, now have to buy water at an expensive rate. So they won't be able to water. The rich, on the other hand, will be able to buy those water tankers. For instance, look at the northwestern states of India. Now, these are the states which have less water. So farmers should be encouraged to grow less water insensitive crops, less water intensive crops and agricultural, products. So that but they are made to produce areas that do not produce have enough water are made to produce agricultural stuff so that cities, metropolitan cities, get our bread in time. Now we should be more water sensitive. Farmers in the northwest don't just expect to continue to grow water intensive crops. They also want free or subsidized power, which now the government is not providing them. So it's an issue of water and power. Now, water by itself does not grow crops. There also is need for power. This complete mismanagement, how power is diverted to various cities. Most of the cities do not, in India, especially agrarian city and rural cities, do not have power supply for 14 hours in a stretch. So all of this is leading to a crisis wherein water is being misused, it's not being saved enough. In a drought situation like this, there is also corruption at various levels. Yesterday, there was a big story on how the water tankers, which are supposed to reach the poor, the money which is allotted to them is being taken by the politicians. So towards the end, it is not the rich that suffer. The rich will eventually pay the price of the water tankers. But the poor will not be able to pay because there are no subsidized rates for water tankers. In a situation like this, there has to be a subsidy. That the poor will only pay this much money, or the poor will get free water from whatever we are allotting. If that scheme is not in place, then eventually the rich will get what they have to because they have the money. The poor are suffering. The poor are suffering. There have been deaths which have been reported. There has been no rainfall, and we are scheduled to have very scanty rainfall across India this year. India is a monsoon-dependent country. Now, you will have years when there will be no monsoon. We will have monsoon deprived rains. I mean, we are towards the end of June, and it has hardly rained 3 days in the country. That means very little water. And we are looking at Chennai right now because it has been the worst hit, but we have to also understand that India by and large is an agrarian country. So it's not just Chennai which will be affected. Now the regions to be affected will go down west because the water, the rainfalls happen from the south to the west. The first city to be affected will be Chennai, and then the cities that will be affected later will be Maharashtra, which is already a drought-ridden area, wherein farmers have been committing suicide over the years because there are no rains and there are no crops. The solution to this is more water management. As I have said, you have to sensitize people, you have to sensitize farmers to grow certain crops. You have to subsidize the rates of water tankers. Seems like, you know, the problem with the Indian government is it wakes up to a crisis when the crisis is halfway through. Instead, the government should wake up months before the crisis. See, monsoons can be, we have MET departments, we have weather departments, who already predict that there is going to be a scanty monsoon. So, and they predict about 4 months ago or 5 months ago. So the government should have had a drought management plan 6 months ago, as opposed to Chennai suffering a complete water blackout. And then the government, it looks and says, oh my God, there's a water problem. Where was the forward planning? Why was the government not sitting in anticipation that yes, we have a problem, that instead of stoking communal politics, we have to address the livelihood of people? So that has not happened, and I think that's the bigger problem. At this point, the government is struggling, and any government will struggle if it starts to address an issue 2 days after the problem starts. So the government is trying, but there's also politics because Chennai shares its border with Karnataka, and they both share the water resources with the Kaveri River. There is a political issue there. So it's trying to resolve the politics behind it. It's trying to do its best. It's trying to divert water from other rivers and other sources. But that's too little too late for India right now. At this point of time, people are dying. There will be farmer suicides, which are being anticipated. And we have done very little. 100 to 200 people have died this year in the water crisis in Chennai. It's not just Chennai which has seen suicides of farmers and people. It's across India. It's just that a drought has happened in Chennai that we are suddenly focusing on that there's so many deaths in Chennai. In Maharashtra, in Uttar Pradesh, in Chhattisgarh, in the northern parts, farmer suicides are a regular pattern every year. There are close to 600 to 700 farmer suicides every year in the western parts. So this has been a recurring problem. It's just that the droughts have happened in Chennai, and this entire international attention to it that we are focusing on the deaths. Now, the deaths have various factors. It's because the farmers are debt-ridden. They have not paid their debts. There are no rains, so they know there's going to be, the crops are not going to grow. So they know that this year too, they will not be able to pay their debts. So they commit suicide because there's no food, they cannot feed, and there is the money lenders, the people who lend the money, increase the interest rate every year. There's corruption there too. So the farmers commit suicide because of that. There are farmers who commit suicide because there is no water, and you know there are health issues. There's a water scarcity, there are health issues that have been spreading around. People are using stagnant water from the gutters and the nalas. That's giving rise to waterborne diseases. People are also dying due to waterborne diseases because people are using stagnant water from a month ago, which is infested with germs. Now that's another problem. That water has not been treated. I remember when we were distributing water tankers 2 years ago, and we would go to the villages too with our water tankers. A fight or a scuffle would break out, and the cops would have to intervene because people would want to have the first right over that water. Now, you can understand, these are people who are deprived of water, and their children are dying, and suddenly they see a water tanker coming, and it's given through pipes. So everybody wants to have their first share because there is no discipline. There is no water allotment. Like, the tankers just come in the village and people just swarm it with buckets, and everybody fights over it, and there's a scuffle and people kill each other. Now, the point is, where are the local authorities when this is happening? Can the local authorities ensure that when the water tankers come, it will be a disciplined set of water tankers, that water is subsidized to each person in the village, as opposed to everybody swarming the water tanker and everybody then also ending up wasting water over that fight, and the water gets wasted. So people are also being killed because of that reason. The mismanagement is at various levels. The mismanagement is from the fact that the government did not anticipate this problem. Despite anticipating, they did nothing to do forward planning. Then there are water tankers, there is corruption in people who distribute water. There is no arrangement of who gets the first right to the water, who needs it the most. Let's give it to that person. There is no such, you know, systematic alignment. So that's also leading to deaths. And so we as an agrarian country, we have still not been able to take environment as a big issue. Ideally, in a country like India, environment should be the biggest issue, but we are not. We think of it as a smaller issue. Even in the annual budget that is being allotted in the country, water is the last or least of concerns. You know, we all think that, oh, India has the Ganges, India has the Yamuna, India has the Brahmaputra, so it will never be water deprived, but it is a water deprived country. Unless you have a tangible plan in place, nothing will work out. So we will keep suffering like that. India, as an agrarian country, I think it is at this point of time, it should send an alarm, such an alarming sound to the world that this is happening to the world's largest democracy. This is happening to a country with 1.3 billion population, and we are staring at gloomy times ahead. We still have water resources. And if that can happen to us, then there are countries in the world which do not have the water resources that India has. It can be worse off for countries which are still not taking their lessons from India. Global warming, climate change is perhaps the biggest threat that the world should be looking at this point of time, and we are just brushing it under the carpet. The world should now wake up to the problem India is facing and understand, not just extend a helping hand to India, but also kind of sensitivize themselves that we are looking at a bigger global problem that is looming over us. So I think this is a big, big learning for the world globally at this point of time. I mean, I saw Leonardo DiCaprio tweeting out about the Chennai situation, saying, you know, it has to be a lesson. I mean, I hope international celebrities, since you know they have a huge popularity, I think they also kind of do their role and talk about the water issues and talk about global warming and environmental issues more and more. Because this is not an India-centric issue. This is a global issue.